have always said to my men friends, if you care for me, darling, you will give me territory. Give me land. Give me land.
Never has a quote been so profoundly needed to be echoed than the words of ancestor actress Eartha Kitt. Her words presently beckon an urgent need as we endure the final wage of land grabbing in urban communities. Simply put, our neighborhoods are being rebuilt, but they are not being done with us in mind. Since 1910, there has been a severe decline in black land ownership, resulting in urban and rural counties with predominantly black populations becoming pockets of enduring poverty. Let's not play games here. This is by systematic design, one that has been on autopilot since at least the death of Martin Luther King over 50 years ago. The key word I mentioned is autopilot, because our plight exists today no longer because of the crack of a whip, but the mental and cultural amnesia we're still under the influence of that started well before the states of this country were even united. Putting it bluntly, we might not be the root of our condition, but we certainly are helping and holding us at bay. What are the three basic needs of survival? Food, clothing, and shelter. A more appropriate order would be land, food, and shelter, for land is the key element to sustainability. Land is a part of our socio-economic complexity, and denied access to land may be the key element in black economic development. Land has been the cornerstone of civilization since we moved from the phase of hunter-gatherer. For black folk, or people of African descent in the United States, or Powhatas for short, land is a part of our socio-economic complexity. It is the umbilical cord that connects us with nature. I find denied access to land may be a key element in black underdevelopment. This enduring poverty I'm speaking of serves as the elephant in the room, for every one of us knows this, yet treats it as taboo to resolve, much less even speak on it. Powhatas' connection to land is rapidly disappearing, and with it goes the cultural, social, political, and socio-economic capital that once sustained us. History is important, for you either know it and can use it to become better from it, or you repeat it with detrimental effects that can span generations. We must understand we are where we are now because we have yet to collectively learn from history. But today, we change this. Over the next few minutes, I will introduce a synoptic historical overview, summing up with a tangible resolution spread out in 4 5-minute segments. These segments are history, economics, cooperatives, and lastly, Black Land Matters. From this, it is my intent and hoping you'll see the value in using cooperative measures to survive as well as compete in the next 20 years.
Yes, I like the rhymes.
All of us are born with the miraculous ability to determine the direction.
When reviewing the topic of black sustainability, since emancipation, Powhatas, or black folk, has found it a challenge to find and then create sustainable settlements. After emancipation, we found ourselves moving to wherever jobs were. The Great Migration of the early 1900s was due to the end of the Civil War and the birth of the industrialization period. Over 7 million Powhatas fled the South to escape poverty and overt racism. Since emancipation, we have been perpetually migrating, never setting root in any one area. This has been a major factor in the destabilization of our communities, which has opened the door for gentrification in all kinds of forms, mainly covered in Neely Fuller Jr.'s now 10 areas of people activity: economics, education, entertainment, health, labor, law, politics, religion, sex, and war. Today, we find history is repeating itself, with many Powhatas now migrating back to the South, but not because of a job boom, but gentrification in many forms. There are less domestic job opportunities resulting in many non-landowners migrating and moving around because they simply cannot afford the rent. As individuals, it's an endless maze, with many ending up living in subpar conditions, with the thought of the white picket fence remaining a pipe dream. Ironically, many do end up living with other families, realizing shared finances is a workable and viable as well as sustainable solution. However, the lack of educational awareness about cooperatives keeps many of us in concentration camp mode. Factor in a lack of trust within ourselves further makes for a collective hopelessness for better conditions. So we merely end up existing day to day, generation to generation. In 2005, 3 years before the recent recession, the median black household had a net worth of $12,124, far behind the median white household, which had a net worth of $134,992. By the official end of the recession in 2009, our median household net worth had fallen to $5,677, more than 50% lost, while the number for whites was $113,149, just over a 10% loss. Overall, from 2007 to 2010, wealth for Powhatas declined by an average of 31%, home equity by an average of 28%, and retirement savings by an average of 35%. In contrast, whites lost 11% in wealth, 24% in home equity, and actually gained 9% in retirement savings. According to a 2013 report by the researchers at Brandeis University, half the collective wealth of African American families was stripped away during the Great Recession. To paraphrase Slate.com's chief political correspondent, Jamel Bowie, if you're familiar with African American history and housing policy, the explicit housing discrimination of the mid-20th century left a mark on the landscape of American home ownership. The combination of redlining, blockbusting, racial covenants, and other discriminatory measures means that even now, a majority of blacks live in neighborhoods with relatively poor access to capital and mortgage loans. According to the 2010 census, 70% of whites own their homes versus renters. Asians are a distant second at 59%. Native Americans and Hispanics follow, and Powhatas are last at 46%. For those of us able to save and afford a home, we aren't as financially secure as our white counterparts. The reason? Middle-class Powhatas are more likely to belong to the lower middle class of civil servants and government workers, professions that in the last 5 or so years have been slashed as a consequence of mass public sector downsizing. So you see, when it comes to our most fundamental reasons for living, progress we have not yet attained. The solution, however, lies in an understanding of economics.
He asked me to kind of quickly talk about my purpose here for this. Well, what is the purpose of running the biggest, best minority network in technology? Is it like philanthropic? Are you trying to give back? Are you trying to help people? And the answer is no, absolutely not. My purpose, as those of you who were last time know, is I'm going to make $1 billion. And that's why you are all here. But once you go into the consumer business, then all of a sudden, how do consumers make decisions? Well, they make decisions based on their culture. They make decisions based on, you know, where they come from, what they're going to listen to, what they're going to buy, what they're going to do. It's all based in who they are. And if any of you have been, and many of you have been, as I have, around the world, what you find is that culture worldwide, the dominant culture, emanates from the United States. So if you go anywhere in the world, you'll hear music from here. You'll see fashion from here. You'll see a lot of things that you say, wow, I know where that came from. And then if you go back and you say, well, where did the culture in the United States come from? Like, it's predominantly from black people, right? Who invented jazz? Who invented rock and roll? Who invented blues? Who invented hip hop? Who invented most of the fashion? And so when you think about, like, how are you going to drive culture? How are you going to sell technology products to consumers? There's a big opportunity, a big untapped opportunity, and I'm going to tap it and get $1 billion.
At the core of economics disparity lie race relations, one of which has been more tense than harmonious. Author and professor at the University of Missouri, Robert Weems Jr. stated, "A truly free people possesses the power to produce as well as consume." He also implored, "The future demands the development of strategies that will stimulate more constructive economic activity within the black community." Historically, Poatas have been at the bottom as producers, while being at the top as consumers. What we may not have focused on is that this stat now has a global effect, as well as returns. Hence Horowitz's profoundly accurate statement. In addition to culture bandits, economic disparity is at the root of this intergenerational dilemma. You'll also find at the core of the historic imbalance of race relations lie economics. And the core of that is the strategy better known as leakage. Author of Our Black Year, Maggie Anderson reports, "A dollar circulates among banks, shopkeepers, and other business for nearly a month in Asian American communities before that money flows out of the neighborhood. In Jewish communities, that neighborhood circulation is roughly 20 days. And in predominantly white Anglo-Saxon Protestant communities, it is 17 days. In Poatas neighborhoods, 6 hours. Where are we in business? Better yet, where are we in ownership? What is our domestic and international contribution to entrepreneurship? Could it be possible our socioeconomic predicament is due to our lack in business development? Less than 2 cents of every dollar Poatas spend in this country goes to black-owned businesses. White-owned firms have an average annual sales of $439,479, whereas black-owned firms, just $74,018. In 1997, Poatas represented 13% of the population, but owned only 3% of all U.S. businesses, which generated 2% of the nation's business revenues. Let's be clear, it is not in the best interest of others to help blacks become more competitive. We live in a capitalistic world where economics is key to resource accessibility. If one moves as an entrepreneur, they afford access to the three basic needs. As a consumer, they are simply feeding someone else's families these needs. A comparative analysis of our socioeconomic conditions shows that Poatas have entered the new millennium much the same way they entered the previous 4 centuries, as impoverished, powerless, and neglected people. For well over 95% Poatas, the money earned to put food on the table for our families come from non-Poatas. This is the source of our problem, for if we created more, we'd have more. If we had more, we'd respect more. As a result of not having attained these needs, we don't respect our communities enough, nor the economic prosperity it brings, because we simply do not own within our communities. Let's be real. Our dilemma comes from a rooted spell of cultural amnesia, seen today evolving into the reason we don't respect our neighborhoods, because we simply don't see us as owners. We don't see ourselves as owners of the corner store, the local supermarket, the dry cleaners, the laundromat, nor even the gas station. This has a psychological effect, for our not seeing ourselves as owners makes us believe we can only be workers. And as evident in most major cities, the unemployment rate hovers between 50 to 60% for Poatas men. This deemed complex formula has the perfect answer to this riddle. Why is unemployment for us so high? Because entrepreneurship is very low. How is it Powatis have a collective purchasing power of nearly $1.5 trillion, yet we have the highest unemployment and crime rates among Powatis males while being just 13% of the U.S. population? In global travel, of the $90+ billion spent each year, we spend nearly half. We think we have no money, when in actuality, we do. There's just no black businesses to give it to. Creating and supporting black businesses creates jobs for black people. As a demographic in terms of marketing, we are the quintessential prime rib to the world economy, primarily because of our history of being 99% consumer and 1% producer. Between 1990 and 2007, Powatis buying power rose 166% from $318 billion to $845 billion. White advertising firms caught on and in 2002 spent $454.9 million to market to us, including cable TV, internet sites, and magazines. In 2006, that spending power jumped by nearly 73% to $791 million. The U.S. Census Bureau data shows that our population of about 40 million is growing 34% faster than the population as a whole, and that the number of Powatis households making at least 75,000 has increased 47% since 2005. It's evident we don't know our power, and there are many diversions to keep us from connecting the dots. Although it's easy for racism to be the igniter to this historical issue, a competent counter has always been in place. We were just lulled to sleep by the illusion of inclusion. Author Walimu Baruti explains, "Credit cards have given many of us the illusion of affluence. It is a serious statement about the state of the economy when individuals stigmatized as bad credit risks are accorded by financial institutions to borrow money for cars and homes. That the bulletin boards on our college campuses are plastered with credit card applications is even more telling. Students are the worst credit risks. They have no job, no money, and no guarantee of a job. Yet, they graduate strapped with thousands of dollars of credit indebtedness. The credit card business venture is more than twice as profitable as any other banking venture because if you borrow $2,500 and pay only the minimum monthly amount due, it would not only take 20 years to pay it off, but you would also have paid over $6,000 in interest. Yet awareness of this has neither kept us from being the most conspicuous of all consumers. For Powatis, banks give lesser home loans, and for those they do, have higher interest rates. On September 28, 2015, Fifth Third Bank Corp agreed to pay $21 million for compensation to Powatis and Hispanic borrowers who were overcharged for car loans. In 1925, 18 Baltimore Neighborhood Associations came together to form the Allied Civic and Protection Association for the purpose of urging both new and existing property owners to sign restrictive covenants, asking owners to commit to never selling to Powatis. And this was legal. Restrictive covenants were not merely private agreements between homeowners. They frequently had government sanction. In Baltimore, the city-sponsored Committee on Segregation organized neighborhood associations throughout the city that could circulate and enforce such covenants. Powatis families were prevented from moving into white neighborhoods by explicit policy of the Federal Housing Administration. The FHA not only refused to insure mortgages for black families in white neighborhoods, it also refused to insure mortgages in black neighborhoods, a policy that came to be known as redlining. Because neighborhoods were colored red on government maps to indicate that these neighborhoods should be considered poor credit risks as a consequence of Powatis living in or near them. The FHA also barred Powatis families from obtaining bank mortgages for house purchases, even in suburban divisions which are privately financed without federal construction loan guarantees. The recent Baltimore riots, triggered by yet another death of a black child, has many thinking the rioters destroyed their own community. But what do we own there? The projects? The drugstore? This is no different than the revolts our ancestors had when they burned the plantation. Oh, we may live there, but owners, we're not. We must understand, at the root of economic deprivation lie the lack of land ownership. A more familiar word is gentrification. In addition to banking discrimination, our inability to maintain land ownership in our communities can be linked to gentrification. This practice, however, goes back as far as the Nile Valley of Kemet. When the missionaries came to Africa, they had the Bible, and we had the land. They said, "Let us pray," and we closed our eyes. When we opened them, we had the Bible, and they had the land. Baruti states, "The argument has been put forth that internationally, Africans are viewed as no more than slave labor, and whoever controls that labor will rule the world. Interestingly, no other people is viewed in this way. This is one of the main reasons why Europeans, Arabs, and Asians are now fighting over the African continent and its human resources. Sadly, so many of us are competing with each other to welcome aliens into our homeland." If you leave it up to their story, history will have you thinking there was only one Black Wall Street. Marcus Garvey once said, "A people without the knowledge of their past history, origin, and culture is like a tree without roots." An awareness of history is vital if we are to exist in the next 20 years. When studying cooperatives, we will find there's no need to reinvent the wheel. We were once very good at it. Historically, we pulled funds together in the form of cooperatives. Cooperatives are pools of people who voluntarily use their services for their mutual, social, economic, and cultural benefit. There are many kinds of cooperatives. Susus, for example, were common, where some evolved into credit unions. Today, there are more than 1 billion members of cooperatives throughout the world. But how many are of African descent? Although cooperatives may be a new term to many, its practice is as old as our history, both in Africa as well as in the Americas pre-emancipation. It can also be documented as recent as during the latter part of the Great Depressions of the 1930s. We see once again, Powhatas had to join forces to survive. This energy was directed towards doing for self. Both Marcus Garvey's United Negro Improvement Association and Brooklyn, New York's Paragon Progressive Community Association served as a driving force to the idea of Black economic independence. Just over a decade earlier in Greenwood, Tulsa, Oklahoma, stood Black Wall Street, a wealthy independent town inhabited and owned by Powhatas that was destroyed in the Tulsa race riots May 1, 1921 by neighboring whites. History's also done a great job in hiding the fact that Tulsa was not the only Black Wall Street. In fact, the original Black Wall Street was in New York City, not far from today's Central Park, originally called Seneca Village. Not far from Wall Street, the nexus of global trade, which once included kidnapped Africans as its commodity. And according to Jessica Gore Nemhart, there were several hundred economically independent Black commons. Garvey's UNIA was the physical manifestation of his belief in doing for self. Through support of the people, they financed a fleet of ships called the Black Star Line, estimated to be worth at least $500,000. Additionally, they maintained grocery stores, a restaurant, a laundromat, a tailor, a millinery and dressmaking shop, and a publishing house. We haven't seen the likes of these efforts since we traded self-reliance for politics, of which have effectively done the job of erasing independence, exchanging it for dependence. In Brooklyn, Paragon went on to create the first black credit union. We find every member of Paragon was also a member of the local UNIA. These ancestors were keeping the idea of Garvey's cooperative economics alive, merely under another name. But as the UNIA faced attacks from both white and black Americans for solely attempting to lift Powhatan's from our lowly state, which was not coincidentally the same time we were refused grant relief, it was instinctively natural for these Garveyites to take the task to show and prove a tangible working mode of self-reliance. In many cases, since local banks found us a risk to grant loans for college tuition, mortgages, or unexpected expenses, received support from Paragon. From 1940s through the 50s, Paragon provided financial backing for Powhatan's to open candy stores, laundromats, restaurants, and printing shops. From this model, we see it was through cooperatives we're able to not only create and support our own economic and business ventures, it also can galvanize leverage for things we all need, like group life and death insurance, as well as other health benefits. The plus is knowing this model works. Paragon grew from $5,000 to $6 million in assets, becoming the example, vanguard, and then facing expulsion from our community as white financial institutions witnessed the true essence of self-reliance and creativity despite facing segregation. What we see and have now are the results of them eliminating our plans of self-determination through politics, which led to gentrification, which next resulted in alternative white businesses that still exist in our communities today. Since Paragon and the height of the UNIA, there hasn't been an effective organization like this in sight, and this wasn't even 100 years ago. See, white folks who give the impression we are worthless and they'd rather do without are in fact doing the opposite. The black gold we were once referred to as kidnapped vassals or thralls, a more appropriate word for slave, they found to be more valuable as consumers. They're effectively able to do this still through our absence of knowing history, erasing it from our history books, while at the same time swarming in our communities in numbers as if the UNIA or Paragon ever existed. The metaphorical Achilles of our movement is not money, and it's not history. It's actually something more taxing. In fact, it's antithetical to our claim of love for black people and culture. What could such a thing be, you might ask? It's psychological, and the ailment is simple. It's our lack of trust in each other.
Listen. Yes, us must trust us. Who? Us must trust, not fuss with us. Us must trust us, discuss trusting us. Us must trust us. Who? Us must trust, not fuss with us. Us must trust us, discuss us, trusting us. Trusting us, us must trust, discuss. Discuss not trusting us, must not fuss. Us with us means us discussing, trusting us. Us must trust us. Who? Us must trust, not fuss with us. Us must discuss trusting us. But am I over your head? Yo, am I over your head?
Collectively, we're the most disunited ethnic demograph on the chart. And while most of our dysfunction can be attributed to global racism, much of it today is on autopilot. Meaning, through our collective ignorance of what you've heard thus far is driven by our reluctance to see it as such. A dysfunction that is curable. We've been lulled to sleep into believing democracy serves the people, when we've clearly been the last in line. All of our social, economic, and health ills have yet to be addressed, and it's about time we realize they may never, unless we attend to these issues ourselves. The Depression of the 1930s should serve as an era of study. From hard times emerged the need to establish a sense of community, helping each other and sharing. It's 80 years plus later. Are we not yet again in the same boat? There is no need to reinvent the wheel to save ourselves. The base of our black sustainable survival lies in the work of our ancestors. We merely need to duplicate their successes and learn from their mistakes. I find this will only be accomplished through cooperatives, coupled with trust. Looking for a solution? I'd like to share one with you. I represent a fourth of the founding members from Brooklyn, New York, with strong Caribbean roots and a passion for nature and the environment, who decided in 2012 to create Duende Natural. Our aim is to create an ecological, sustainable future for ourselves, our children, and our communities. We go by the virtues of living in nature, for nature lives within us, and natural, organic, and earth-friendly practices is an everyday practice and lifestyle. We use earth-based living skills, nature awareness, and indigenous practices to create a partnership within our members, visitors, students, and the environment, using the tenets of permaculture, of which there are three ethics: care for the earth, care for people, and fair trade. In 2013, we bought 10 acres of pristine raw jungle on the Caribbean coast of Costa Rica. Part of it will be an eco lodge and the rest an intentional community. As beautiful and peaceful as Costa Rica is, after the noticeable increase of social response, namely by the Black Lives Matter movement, we realized the need to address our collective domestic hardships was in need of immediate attention. At the core of Powhatan's problems is the increased loss of land ownership. Black Land Matters was born. Most of the time, investment in real estate and concern for local community are seen as oxymoronic. For example, Brooklyn, New York is now the most expensive real estate market in the United States. If you hear this and you own real estate in Brooklyn, or your pension is invested in urban real estate, you smile as if you made a wise investment. But if you rent in Brooklyn, you see displacement and loss of community in your future. This is happening in urban cities all around the country. But what if investment in real estate and concern for local community went together? With the Real Estate Investment Cooperative for Permanently Affordable Space, we are doing just this by combining people power with money power. As a member of Black Land Matters Real Estate Investment Cooperative, BLM REIC for short, you will receive details of domestic and international projects and listings. Wherever black folk are, black land matters. Our purpose is to pool our money to create a fund that we manage together. If 1,000 people give $100 to the fund, we have $100,000 to work with. But if 10,000 give $100 to the fund, that's $1 million. We are using the power of social media networking to bring economic possibilities to our people. We can decide to inject capital into projects that, one, buy land property from private owners to stabilize existing businesses and community spaces, and two, turn vacant properties into sustainable community resources. Members join BLM REIC for a $50 annual investment for a voting share. We decide together as a cooperative how to spend the money we pool. Each project we invest in will have both social value and be financially feasible. Because winning as an individual is quite difficult, everyone seems to be trying to solve this problem of affordability on an individual level. I've shown you historically, we've learned that past successes relied on people working together, on aggregation and scale, and not on the individual. Building a co-op pool of resources enable group improvement and sustainability instead of doing it on your own. Through BLM's parent company, Duende Natural, we have a model intended to create intentional communities of like-minded folks focused on land as well as food sovereignty via the use of the same practices of our ancestors, cooperatives. Our reasons for creating BLM REIC are the following. We believe African diasporic heritage-based communities must come together to pool resources and share our experiences as we reclaim our sacred connection with the earth. We want returns on our investments to be made locally. We want to shape our communities together. We want to see development without displacement. We want to support space for art and culture. And we want to preserve a business or community space in our own neighborhoods. Black Land Matters serves as a space to learn, think deeply, radically, and personally about the best ways to keep our communities on the land and keep it alive and green for ensuing generations. were working together to secure cooperatively purchased and permanently owned black land. In this time of climate change and dwindling natural resources, it's imperative that we implement these practices which will support community and earth sustainability. The properties we currently seek are to be acquired in New York City, Philadelphia, the Baltimore, D.C. region, Atlanta, and California, with other areas to follow based on demand, resources, and the ability to organize divisions that include international sites. If any of this speaks to you, consider joining us at our virtual and in-person soirees to learn more at this link. And if you haven't already, join the BLM REEC membership today at this link. And lastly, consider coming with us on one of our domestic and international tours to Costa Rica and see for yourself. Go to our site for details of this year's tours. Asante Sana, Ubuntu, Abibi Fahodie.
Children of nature, from another culture, had to survive.